get those brilliant engineers, programmers, you don't know what the heck they're talking about. But if they can communicate well, they end up with great careers. The core of what we teach is what I learned when I was in business school. It's been 10 years already. Where's the time go? So I went to a Penn State's MBA program, and the communications we took was just terrific. And I eventually started a business based on what I learned. First handout.
Oh, yes, sorry about that.
So we're going to get started with that right away. So the first thing we're going to talk about is structure. How do you structure a seminar, a presentation, an email, a report, an executive summary? And once we get through that, we're going to talk about how to sell ideas to senior leadership. So before we do that, tell me a little bit what roles you are currently working now. All part-time students, for the most part, or is that
true? Well, they're full-time, part-time mix. Everyone is evening classes, right? There's nobody that takes day classes here.
Okay.
So almost everyone is working full-time or part-time, but
people complete the MBA at their own pace.
So we're going to start off with the structure. The first thing you see is the introduction. And I'm going to go through a couple introductions. One, you're going to say, he doesn't build any credibility. The next one is going to say, wow, you really know what he's talking about. I need to listen to that guy. So when you do when you give a seminar or presentation or anything, the first thing you got to do is build credibility. That's what your introduction is all about. The next thing is going to be your residual message. Whenever you give a talk, people are going to remember one thing. You're going to give them this much information, they're going to remember this much. If everyone remembers something different, you probably didn't do such a good job. You want to get that one clear nugget they're going to take away. The next thing we have there is what I like to call the quack, killer wake-up call. Killer wake-up call is just that. It's a wake-up call. Uh-oh, we have an emergency here. In my consulting career, we had a client where it's a bread manufacturer. Their safety was so atrocious, people getting hurt, literally killed on the job at a bakery. And the killer wake-up call we gave them was, you've got to sell $250 million worth of hamburger buns to pay for your on-the-job injuries. Think about that. Not $1 million worth, $250 million worth of hamburger buns. And each hamburger bun is only a few cents. So they said, oh, wait a minute, maybe we ought to do something about this. Then the with them is a what's in it for me. Then you'll see there's three pieces of evidence. I always start with three, and sometimes I go to two, sometimes five, whatever. For each, we're going to state the problem, then state the evidence, define it, a little more support, relate it back to the audience, and then wrap up with a residual message. This is your basic structure, and I'm going to go through a talk here, and I want you to follow along and say, hey, did we do this? And then you can judge me. Tell me if I did or not. And by the way, this is not going to be me talking for 2 hours. Just so you know, I'm entertaining, but not that entertaining. We have a bunch of group exercises. So we're going to have a group of four, group of three. And you are going to solve some very basic, they're really easy case studies, a paragraph, and you'll present the information using the structure and a few other tools we got. So, part one, structure. Couple of principles. This came from Andy Gustafson. He was my professor at Penn State. Every communicative act is infinitely improvable. You can always get better. So edit, edit, edit. The more times you look it over, the better you're going to get. Pointer?
There's an infrared there.
It's good for driving your dog crazy.
Yeah.
You guys ever do this to your black lab? Watch her go nuts. I made this letter longer than usual because I lack the time to make it short. When you deal with executives, they're not going to read a long essay, one or two paragraphs. Lee Iacocca said, I stopped reading after two paragraphs. That was 40 years ago, and our attention spans have gotten shorter and shorter. When you go on LinkedIn, you read all those articles, who reads the whole thing? Anybody?
No.
You just read the bullet points, the listicles, they call them. I read the 10 reasons that you should do A, B, and C. You just read the quick thing. So keep it brief. Come on in. And one of our core principles, look at things from the listener's point of view. We are going to go over this over and over and over again, where it's not going to be your residual message. hopefully by the end of the day, it's just going to be so ingrained in your head that you're going to do this every single time. Next, for part one, this is a residual message. If you walk away with one thing and one thing only from this first part, you can improve your communication skills by using a structure, thinking it through, organizing your thoughts, and then presenting it. Got it? Clear as a bell? Clear as mud? So let me go back to an introduction. I'm going to give you two. You got some which you like better. Two introductions. Hi, my name is Gordon Adelsberg. My education, both undergraduate and graduate degrees, is in food science. You know, all those chemicals in the back of a food label. I have some products that were released nationally, and I own a food business, an ice cream business down in North Carolina for many years. And I did this and that, and now I've got a communications business. Credibility? Good answer. All right, let me try it again from this side. Hi, I'm Gordon Adelsberg. I come from a very technical background, actually food science, biochemistry, and statistics. I own businesses along the way. And I went off to business school, and I learned some really good communication skills. The following 10 years, I worked in management consulting, traveled all over the country, all over the world. And what I found is whenever we were successful, we communicated our findings, the value to the client. We communicated it really well. Whenever we failed, either we or our clients did something where the message did not get through. So I looked back on what worked and what didn't work, and I realized, hey, this is really good stuff. I know I can teach this to people, and I think I can do a whole lot of value. So I put my consulting on the back burner, and I launched a business called Communication for Geeks. And I want all of you to succeed. That's our mission. Better?
Yep.
Okay. So both are factually true. So when you do that introduction, make sure you build credibility. Now, back to where we were. Anybody a project manager? Anybody heard of PMP, PMI? What? Okay. It's Project Management Institute. It's a trade organization for project managers, which was my last title when I worked for a big company, which I recommend y'all don't do. But they have a magazine, and what they say is, when projects fail, when they're over budget, behind schedule, just complete failures, the vast majority is due to communication failures. It's about 90%. Now, how many people in your current day jobs have to do some of these things? Raise your hands. Okay. When you fail, when these things don't work, this same thing holds true. It's usually due to communication failure. We can prevent that. Next thing I got from the PMI, they did a bunch of studies and they said, what are the things that make it successful? And PMBOK is the project management body of knowledge. But this holds true for almost every profession. If you can't communicate well, especially if you're a technical person, your career is going to be limited. The ones who communicate very well, they do great. Has anybody ever heard of SaaS? It's a software company out of North Carolina. Not software as a service. SAS, SAS Institute, largest privately held company in the world, software company in the world. Okay, statistical analysis systems. I think they're probably about $2 billion in revenue now down in Raleigh. The guy who ran it, who runs it, is just brilliant. He's a statistician from NC State. He hired a marketing guy who would yap. I had no idea what this guy was talking about. But Jim Goodnight, the brilliant PhD statistician who runs the company, owns it. One sentence, you knew the entire story. Put it in perspective, he's Fortune 50. So if you read Fortune magazine, look for the richest people in the world, in the country, you'll see Jim Goodnight, tall, handsome billionaire. Yes, I'm jealous. He owns half of North Carolina, and he's by far the smartest person I've ever been near. He's just a brilliant guy. But one of the reasons he's so successful is because he's just a phenomenal communicator, clear, concise, to the point. So if you, as young, budding entrepreneurs, engineers, your academia, if you can communicate well, sky's the limit for you. All right, the IIBA, they say the same thing. That's the International Institute of Business Analysis. They're very similar to the PMI. They're one of those trade organizations. So I I did a little research to see where the people at the top of these organizations rank communication skills. Villanova, they said, well, to be successful, it's number one. The body of knowledge for the business, for the IIBA, same thing. Anybody heard of Dice.com? Job search website, kind of like Monster.com, but for tech. They say communication. But then all these other ones, all these reasons, all these other skills you need, they're all these other things, and personal management, mentoring, coaching, it's all communication. All right, run it. So, to be successful, you really need to understand, to have some fundamental and solid communication skills. So let's go through what we got here. What do you think? This is time for you guys to speak up. Introduction. Yes, no, did we get the concept that build credibility?
Yes.
Okay. Residual message, did we get it?
Yeah.
Okay, what was the residual message? I'm asking as a group.
Okay.
Quiet group.
The residual message for what we should remember from the first part was that you can improve your communication skills based on structuring what it is.
Right. And there are several structures. I use this one because, well, I like it. It's simple. I'm familiar with it. There's ABCD model. There's just a whole host of them out there. But find one that works for you. This one, I think, is great. It's simple and it's robust. Killer wake-up call. Did that come through? Yes, no? I got blank stares, so that means no. Let's see. Killer wake-up call. What about this? Project failures? Your projects will fail. Okay. Wiffum, this is what's in it for me. Here is your career. This could be your career. Who wants this career? Who wants this career? So, what's in it for me? Not me, personally. What's in it for... Who's heard the term Wiffum? Nobody? Before today.
Oh, okay.
We used to a lot of everything we write to management. So it's part of our management techniques that we're supposed to follow.
Thank you, absolutely. Okay, so let's get back to where we were here. The Wiffum, what's in it for me? So maybe they weren't as clear, maybe it's because the first time you've seen this, but we're going to go through this several times, and by the end of the night, this is going to be easy for you. We need humor in every presentation. Who remembers Groucho Marx? I think he died when I was in the high to a grasshopper. Anybody? I guess I need to get some more updated references. Let's look at these communication skills. I once shot an elephant in my pajamas. How I got my pajamas, I'll never know. So how many people have been guilty of doing that? And you look at what you wrote and you say, well, that doesn't make any sense. Or someone reads it and okay, yeah. Nobody's heard of Groucho Marx. One, good, all right. So, back to where we were. First piece of evidence here. When you have a good structure, it's going to help you think through what's important to the other person. So, remember, any communicator back, you got the sender, and you got the receiver here. How many people have seen a conversation where you look at the conversation, you say, is that person listening or waiting for the other one to stop talking? Yeah. Okay, how many people have been that person talking? Let's be honest. Be honest. Hopefully I'm asked that me today. So when you're the sender, which is kind of what we're talking about here, make sure the things that can go wrong is you're not sending the correct message, or there's no urgency. Using a lot of colloquialisms and acronyms. Anybody here work in engineering or work with engineers or government people? Okay. Acronyms, initialisms. We all know what the FBI and the CIA are. But from my background, I was actually working in process safety, how to keep the plants from blowing up. Things like PHA, PMI, the MOCs. This was just our normal language. But for the outsiders, they had no idea what we were talking about. They looked at us, what is this stuff? So be very careful of acronyms, and also be careful of the clutter. Long emails, what's the point? Your manager's only going to read the first sentence. Receiver. One of the things we do is we make assumptions, we're impatient. How many people have done this, thinking about the response instead of listening? Okay, I have three hands and everyone else is lying, because I know we've all done this. So, first thing, it's good when you really think through the structure of your seminar, presentation, email, the report you're going to give to your boss, it's going to help you think through what's important to that listener. And also, another thing, side note here, ask questions. Repeat back to what the person said. Next thing, when we talk about the WIFM, when you structure your thinking, it's going to help you think through what is really important. We're going to do some exercises on this. But one way to look at this is where you are now. The WIFM is over here. For instance, if you're selling a new concept where the person can increase the revenue by 50%, you can say, okay, you're making $1 million now, but what would it be like if you were making $1.5 million? Oh, well, here's all the other things that you could do. So I've been struggling with a good way to present this graphically. So if anybody can come up with a better way of presenting the what's in it for me graphically, I will give you a prize of something. I don't know what it'll be. So any feedback, any suggestions you have, because remember, every communicative act is infinitely improvable. Next, now we're going to do some exercises. To start figuring out the WIFM, we're going to go with a simple stakeholders analysis. Who's used the stakeholder analysis? Anybody? Who's going to go into consulting or thinking about it? Thinking about it? Consulting tool number one. This is one you need to know. Suppose a farmer changes his family's breakfast from oatmeal to ham and eggs. Who are the stakeholders? Would you like to do this as a group or break into teams? Oh, we have time. Oh, by a group. Let's do this as a group. Do we have, I can do it over here. Do we have a poster board or?
We have dry erase boards. The library closes at 7, I'm sorry.
I'll do it this way. How about this? Why don't we talk through this? Can you all still read that?
Yes.
Okay. So the farmer is going to change his family's breakfast. And this is a silly example, but it's going to get you thinking about this. What we're going to do is we're going to talk through... Go away. Where is... How do I make this full screen again?
There you go. Yep.
Okay. Stakeholder analysis for all your future consultants of the world. You list who's going to be affected by the change, and then can they influence the change? They have influence on it? Are they influenced by the change? Hey, it's coming to them, but they can't do anything about it, but they get affected, they don't get affected. What's the reaction going to be, and what are their concerns? Whenever I'm putting a seminar together or an email to my senior management or a client, I go through this exercise. Now, this is where you guys talk. We're going to do this as a group. And then the next one, we're going to split into teams. So the farmer, who are the stakeholders? Okay, let's be more specific here.
Wife.
Okay, let's say the wife, the mom. So let's say this is an
old-fashioned
1950s generic white bread and mayonnaise family in the Midwest. So we got the mother, okay? Who else?
Children.
What's that?
Children.
Children, thank you. All right, I've got the people in the back chiming in. All right. Children, let me see if I can spell this correctly. Children. Who else is going to be influenced by this change?
The farmer himself.
The farmer, sure. Farmer. Okay, there's two other big stakeholders that I can think of.
Pigs and...
I like it.
And chicken.
The pig and the hen. Okay. Look good? You guys can read this? You have better vision than me. So think about this 1950s old style family. So now we're going to talk about influence on the change. Does the mom have influence? Is she high, medium, or low?
Aye.
Medium, okay. Medium high depends on the family. The children, do they get to make decisions?
Nope.
Okay, so they're going to be low. How about the farmer?
High.
High. Okay, what do you think the pig? Does he get a
low.
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 The hen? Low. Okay. Influenced by the change. High, medium, or low?
Medium.
Okay. Is that right here? So she's got to cook oatmeal, she's got to cook eggs. Is it that much different? Children?
Medium.
Okay, let's get to quickly. Farmer? Medium?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you think? What about the pig?
High.
Okay. And then the hen?
High.
Why do you say high? Low?
It's not,
why do you say low?
It's not really going to hurt the hen by using
her. She's laying eggs or going to the grocery store. She's laying eggs or going to the farmer's store. Will she even notice?
No.
Okay. Low. Okay. Before we get too deep into this, let's just talk through the rest. I think you all get the hang of it. So the next reaction to the change, what do you think that's going to be for the mom? What's that?
Neutral. It doesn't matter.
So she's neutral. She might be positive. Now let's go back to this because this is important. So she's probably, I'm going to say she's plus. There's a plus sign. Children, what do you think?
Plus.
Okay, something different. Farmer, he's for it.
Yeah.
Plus. Pig.
Negative.
He's not going to be too happy about it. And the hen? Equal. Neutral. Okay. The next thing I'll do is I'll go through their concerns. That's too much time for me. So if you have to make this change and you've got to convince all these people to get on board, where are you going to spend your time? Yeah. Well, you got to convince this guy. This is going to be hard. You know the difference between committed and involved? Ham and eggs breakfast. The chicken is involved. The pig is pretty committed. Ham and eggs. Okay. Little joke. Okay, so anyways, the next thing you're going to do is go through their concerns. So mom would be nutrition, kids would be desert taste, farmer probably nutrition, pig, well, hey, I'm going to die. The hen probably has no concerns because she's very low. So this is a very basic stakeholders analysis. I've used these all the time. So anybody that's going to go into any kind of change management, learn this tool, use it, love it. Next. When you take what you just saw and you put it into an organizational structure, you're going to see through, you've got to think through each organization, each level of the organization, what's important to them. You got the C-suite. C-suite means chief executive officer, chief operating officer, chief, what do you call it? Chief financial officer. Thank you. Then you got the mid-level, upper management directors, and then the rank and file here. So these guys, when you start thinking about what's important, they think outside of the organization. When you're communicating to senior leaders, they're thinking, what new regulations are coming? What are my competitors doing? Where are the market shifts? Where are the big trends? What is going on outside of all the day-to-day activities? These guys, directors and business leaders, when you talk to people at this level, they're concerned about return on investment. All right, we're building a new production line. What's it going to cost? We're going to use a new marketing automation software. Well, how many people am I going to have to train? Which teams are going to be broken up if I have to move a guy to a different location? And ultimately, return on investment. Down here, operations guys, sales, QC, that's where you get into the nitty-gritty. That's where you get down into the details. They think inside the organization. So in your day-to-day lives, where do you guys typically, where are you right now? Do you typically do here, here, here? Is it a mix?
Inside.
Inside? How about, does that make sense? Mix? Generally, earlier in your career, you're here, and as you move up, get up here. Okay, now it's time for you guys to do your stuff. We have 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. All right, let's break into two teams, and you're going to solve a quick case study. Your CEO asks you to analyze two companies and make recommendations of which to acquire. Alpha Analytics is in the financial distress and you can be purchased on the cheap. So you can get Alpha Analytics. They got great technology, great people, and it's really cheap. Delta Data is expensive, but you can reduce your operating expenses. List the stakeholders and fill out this matrix. So how do you want to break this up? 5 and 4? So I'm going to give you 10 minutes. Don't get too deep into the details because you're not getting graded on this. I want you to learn the concepts, start thinking through. How about team left? Do you want, which one? Which company do you want?
Alpha Analytics.
Alpha Analytics. You all get Delta Data.
Okay.
So let's take 10 minutes, fill this out, just make a little grid on a sheet of paper, and then in a couple minutes you're going to report back to me. And I'll just sit here and stare.
Get the video camera on you. Oh.
Oh, let me get out of your way, see if you can read the screen. Yeah, they're trading on the New York Stock Exchange.
Still waters run deep in this class.
I started at DuPont. One of the trainers said, remember, once you even find the living room, it's a day.
I'll be right back. I'm just going to get some copies for next class.
By the way, we're going to do a bunch of these exercises, so everyone's going to have to be the team spokesman. We're going to rotate through. So you're going to recommend using Delta Data.
I got it as
A couple hints. The best way I find it is just list all the stakeholders. Just brainstorm. So CEO, was it the CFO, is he a stakeholder, the operations guys, the company being purchased, stockholders. Just, who's influenced by this? Yeah. Now, there's realistically, you can come up with 20 different groups. But let's just pick 5 that you think matter the most, because I don't need to be here all day. You're supposed to learn the concepts here, not.
Yeah, it's just the opposite.
Do we care about our
it's general purpose. I think it's just like we have just general stuff. But it's just
one is
yeah.
One is a discredit for just cheap with the other one was there and they didn't write the same one rank. So it's just
like a
high
level.
Yeah. Okay, so you're saying, hey, we recommend Alpha Analytics, this, and then you're going to go through the stakeholders list. So, yeah, don't get too deep into which company it is.
So, the CEO will get it cheaply, so they have to pop
That's welcome to, in the business world, you never have all the information you need.
Most employee directors, because they're the ones that are like worried about the logistics. If my job is to file paperwork on those.
And this screen I can lift up.
They want success for the company.
Okay, let's make sure you get one or two to share to the larger group here. Let's take one more minute and we'll wrap this up. The reaction for the CEO. Direction for the Okay. How about the stuff? It is what it is. All right, so let's get this get moving forward here. It's okay, you're supposed to struggle with this stuff. If it were easy, you wouldn't be learning anything. So, Alpha Analytics, give me two of your stakeholders and tell me what you came up with.
We came up with Alpha Analytics itself.
Yeah, just give me, you have a list of stakeholders,
right?
Just, let's just pick two unless, pick any two you want.
CEO?
CEO of Alpha Analytics or your CEO?
Our CEO.
Okay, good. CEO, and who's the other one?
CEO of Alpha Analytics.
CEO of the buyer and of the buyee. Okay. So what influence does he have on the change? Hi, medium low?
Hi.
All right. Influenced by the change?
Positive.
And reaction?
Positive.
Over here?
Yes.
Okay. I would say... Well, influenced by the changes. Is he influenced? Is he highly influenced?
Highly, yes.
Okay. Why do you say that?
His decision is going to affect the whole company.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough. What do you think his concerns are?
To save money.
Save money? Okay. Could be. Since this is just a one-sentence case study, it could be a whole host of things. But start thinking about what's important to that guy. That's your starting point. Then you move on to say, okay, if I'm going to present information to him, maybe I ought to do some research, but this is my hypothesis. And the CEO of Alpha Analytics.
We said influence on change was medium.
Medium? Okay.
And influence high?
Influenced by the change?
By the change?
Yeah, because he's going to be no longer CEO.
Right.
He's out of a job. Yeah, or demoted.
We said reaction was positive.
Positive? Why that?
Because he'd make a profit by selling off his business.
Could be. Okay.
That's what our concern was, to make profit.
Profit. Okay. Yeah, I mean, you got to make up stuff because it's... So it could be that, gee, my other alternative is bankruptcy or, you know, we just fold. Okay. Delta Data, let's pick a couple of stakeholders.
We have also our CEO.
See, okay.
And our, just a couple?
Yeah, just pick one other one.
Our operating staff.
Oh, okay, cool. Ops. Cool. So this, tell me what your CEO thinks about all this.
The influence on the change for the CEO is high.
Influence on the change, right? Because he's driving it. He's the boss.
His influence by the change also is very high.
Okay. And reaction?
Their reaction is positive.
Okay.
So they're going to save money in the long run. So.
Okay. So his concern is dollars?
$2.
Okay.
And for ops, it's the influence on the change is low. They don't really have a say.
Sure. Okay.
But they are influenced by it as more like a medium.
Could be.
Because they're going to do more work.
Yep.
And the reaction to the change should be the same.
Okay. Could be neutral.
Yeah.
Who knows? It could be positive, it could be negative. But yeah, so. And what are their concerns?
We talked a little bit about people losing their jobs, so.
Okay.
We didn't want to fire anyone from our company.
Actually, no, that's great, because now when you're communicating this change, now that you've thought this through, hey, wait a minute, this is the merger, you have redundancies, what happened to the redundancies?
Yeah.
Layoffs. Good, good. Okay. So you're starting to get it. I like it. Okay, cool. Now I feel comfortable moving forward. Questions, comments? Is this the most brilliant thing you've ever seen or too rudimentary? Most brilliant thing?
Yes.
Good answer. Next thing. And we're going to talk a ton about this in the second half. So I kept, even though this is the most important part, it's going to be very short for right here. When you put together a seminar, email, whatever, you're going to have a mountain of data. And you have to funnel it down here. See, this is my mountain. You're going to have process maps and logistical reports, all this stuff. You got to funnel it down and say, what is the one thing that's really important for them to know? So I'm thinking for the ops folks, what's really important for them to know? Maybe, hey, this gives you more opportunities to advance, or you will not lose your job.
Yeah.
So, and for the CEO, what is that one thing? You're thinking about that. Hey, we can reduce our operating costs. They don't want to see all the synergies and all this other nonsense. Look how much money we can save. Put a dollar amount down. Edit. When I put together this seminar or any report, any class, and remember we did this, the one that we're developing, same thing. This is my starting point, this lecture, and then I edit, and then my residual message changes as I get a better understanding of what it is I'm trying to do. You'll never get it right the first time. That's okay. Questions about residual message? Next, who's heard this? Picture's worth 1,000 words. It is true. Who has heard of the Swan's test? Probably nobody, because I made it up. It's so what and next steps. It's just a little acronym I put together, a little mnemonic to remember. A friend of mine is she's a director at Cisco, and I was doing some research for some of this stuff, and I said, Jules, tell me what are the problems you're having? She said, people give me these slides, and I look at them and say, yeah, well, so what? And then another guy is a friend of mine from college. He worked at American Express, now Bank of America, hotshot, a big time HR dude, VP, whatever. He said, people ask me stuff, and I said, what do you need from me? What are the next steps? So I put together some next steps. Oh, yeah, I put this together, SWANS. The SWANS test. Feel free to use this whenever you want. Whenever you're going to send something to your senior leaders, look at it and say, from their standpoint, well, so what? What are the next steps? Does your work pass the SWANS test? You like? Remember it? I'll stick with you. You'll give me credit for it. You'll tweet out about it. Okay, great. Okay, so graphics. And the SWANS can really definitely help you with the graphics. So let's go through a quick exercise. Future consultants of the world. Let's just say you're an operational efficiency consultant, my other career, which I left behind for this business. Your client is a pizza parlor, and they want to improve their operational efficiency. We want to cook quicker and faster. The first thing you have to do is understand how this Domino's, Papa John's, how it works. So you write up a little report like this. You ask them, this is what they tell you. There's mud. What do you think? Does everyone understand?
That's a lot of words.
Exactly. That's a lot. Okay. Here is the exact same information shown graphically. Do you understand the entire thing within 10 seconds?
Yes.
Okay. That's my little test for a good graphic. You can take a complex flow, complex data, complex whatever, but put it in 10 seconds. So here, I love these process maps. It's called a multifunctional, I don't know, I call it a swim lane process map. Here's your stakeholders, all the people involved, and then this is what they do. And this is this should have a yes, no box there, but it's okay for now. Maybe we'll let that slide. Either way, you know exactly what the story is. So let's talk about one from my career a long time ago. Does this pass the SWANS test? This is from my master's degree back in North Carolina. Anybody from North Carolina? Anybody? Okay. We did some work on production. We are making peanuts, processing peanuts. We wanted to increase the production capacity of the plant, so we changed the methodology. Does this tell you anything?
No.
No? Here's method one. Here's the maximum. Here's our production. Peanuts are harvested in August, October. So we pull them out in September, October, all of our roasting here. But with a new one, we can spread it out over the course of the year. Is that, what's your, so what?
Yeah.
Okay. So here's a better way, not the best way, but a better way of presenting the same information. How about this?
Yeah,
that. So, oh, well, that catches my interest. This is still, there's still room for improvement here. But what this says is, hey, I'm here and I can only produce here, and then my plants are idle for the rest of the year. But here, look at this. Wow, I doubled my capacity without adding any capital expenditure. A little bit better, same data, same information, but a good graphic can help you explain why this is important. Questions on peanut manufacturing?
Is frozen peanuts?
No, it's just when they come out of the ground. If you Google my name, you'll see some papers that I wrote years ago, lifetimes ago. All right, let's do a review of part one. Introduction. Alpha Analytics team, someone tell me what's the point of an introduction? What are you trying to get out of it?
To give you insight into the topic.
Credibility. When you do your introduction, you remember I did the one where I talked about my food science background,
right,
and you said, I don't care. And then I spoke about the one saying, here's my management consulting, here's the tools I've used, here's why I do this. And what did you guys say?
Yeah.
I should listen to that guy. Okay, Delta team, what's a residual message? Did it get through? I got blank stares. Maybe. What I want you to walk away with from this first half of the lecture, the one thing is take a structure, use this structure or any other structure, and it's going to make your presentations much better. It's going to make your emails much better, your reports to your bosses much better. Use this simple, robust structure or anyone that you find, do some research, and you will definitely improve. Killer wake-up call. You remember project failures? If you can't communicate well, it'll fail. What's in it for me? Who remembers that slide? The graph? Who can tell me the what's in it for me? That's the benefit for you. Yes?
You're 5 times more likely to advance in your career if you have good communication skills.
Got it. All right. Everybody got that?
Yes.
Someone repeat that back to me. What's the what's in it for me for you guys?
You're 5 times. More likely to succeed.
Right. This is, and then we had our 3 bullet points and then residual message. So now we are going to examine an article, and you're going to use the structure to look at somebody else's. So this article came from the Project Management Institute. We are going to examine it. It might be good, it might be bad. There are no right answers, there are no wrong, well, there's plenty of wrong answers. There's plenty of right answers, plenty of wrong answers. And everyone who hasn't spoken yet, you are going to speak sometime over the course of the day. So just skim through this, glance over. Everybody have one?
Yep.
Okay. So skim through this, take a look, and then we're going to discuss it as a group. Okay, let's not get too deep into this. So what do y'all think of this article? Now, let's use it in this context here. So what are your general thoughts?
It does a good job of setting up what you're about to read in the first paragraph.
Okay.
With the problem.
Okay.
It introduces what the article is going to be about.
Sure. So a little bit of basic credibility, if you will, a little introduction. Okay. Folks over here, what do you think? The quiet folks who haven't spoken yet. Everyone's going to get a chance to talk today. So. Okay. This group, did you find a killer wake-up call in here anywhere? Something that makes you say, wow, this is really important.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
What did you find?
Yep. That could be me.
Yeah, exactly.
Or my relatives. It's
like, wow, this is important. Yeah, and I'm looking at the clock down here. Hospital-acquired infections cost the U.S. $30 billion. Huh. Or is it up here? Well, it's going to be different for every person. That's okay. But that's the thing that makes you say, oh, wow, I should read more. This is important. This is a real problem.
This is for me.
I don't know. Tell me, what is it?
I don't know, but it should be one.
Okay, I'm not saying this is the best article.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying it's the worst article. Well, let's just examine it for what it is. So, now, keep in mind who this is targeted to. It's part of the Project Management Institute, so it's a bunch of project managers. So, you notice how they start with project teams. Everything has to be a team nowadays. All right, so if you were to change this article to improve it, what would you do? Anything?
I'd probably make it a little bit more concise, just because I skimmed it anyway, like you were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
So I do like that it's numbered and you kind of have the solutions right there, and then if you want to know more, you can read more.
Yep. So it's got the... here's the three things. This is what we're doing. Here's the three main pieces of evidence. And we got our intro. We got our killer wake-up call. Do you find one main message in here? No? So if you were to read this, what would you take away?
Interesting.
Yeah, interesting. Is it going to be memorable?
Maybe.
I guess it depends.
It doesn't say when they're going to fix it, or it doesn't talk about when this is expected to happen.
Okay, so it's not necessarily, they don't have the directness that you like to see in the structure, the timeliness. Okay. What I really want you to get out of this is just start looking at stuff from an analytical standpoint and say, hey, did they really get their message across? Was it really clear? So for project managers, maybe you'd look at it and say, well, okay, here's some things that some people are doing. So I don't know. I didn't want to show you the best article. I want to show you something that's going to make you think. So one or two more thoughts, and we're going to stand up, do a stretch, and move on to the next part. One or two more interesting things on here. Any others?
Shark skin surfaces. That caught my attention.
Okay.
I was thinking also the robots that disinfect. They were saying that it takes 10 minutes to disinfect the robot.
Okay.
And to, you have to pay someone to do it. An individual person. So I think that was a good thing.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, I would say that might be one of the main things here. Hey, new methods can new stuff to disinfect a room in 10 minutes.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. I didn't even see that. Yeah, maybe that ought to be the residual message, or maybe that ought to be the what's in it for me. Oh, very, very clear, because when your what's in it for me and your killer wake-up call, they can overlap. They can be the same. It depends. But yeah, that's a good point. Hospital, new technology, clean a room completely in 10 minutes. Wow. then if I'm a hospital administrator, I say that's going to save me a fortune in cleaning fees. There you have a different what's in it. Different what's in it. Okay, so on this structure, before we move forward, what do you think? How can you use this? Questions, comments? Wow. You guys got a lot of dollars. Okay, so do you guys need to get up, stretch a little bit, or you want to keep rolling? Take a 2-minute break for a little bit of water, bathroom?
We usually don't take a break, but we usually just pile through. But
keep going through?
There you go.
Okay. We saw this, we did that, we did that.
Do you need a break, Gordon?
No, I'm good. Part 2, selling to top executives. You guys are in MBA school now. This is going to be part of your career. I like it or not, you need to learn how to do it. It's not easy. I'm not as good at it as I would like to be, and nobody ever is. Keep learning, keep striving, get better, and get better, get better. So we're going to go through a couple tips and techniques. You're going to have to remember what you learned this past hour. So we believe, like you came up with a way to improve this. Every communicative act is infinitely improvable. I made this longer. Who said that you'd like to see this shorter? Listener's point of view. Remember, who's reading this? And I want you to start thinking outside the company. It's difficult to do. How many times have you heard when you give a lecture, when you're doing a talk, where you're giving a presentation, seminar, tell a story? How many times have you heard that? A million times?
Yeah.
Okay. How do you tell a story if you don't know the story? How do you think in this chief executive's mindset if you've never been a chief executive? You've never been the COO. It's hard. But there's some tricks you can do, and that's what we're going to go through here. We've seen this, right? Here's my killer wake-up call. Here's my what's in it for me. If you can think like the C-suite, you're going to be along this path. If you can't, potential, just that. So when I was knee-high to a grasshopper, my dad was working at Corning. He worked there for, he still works there, I don't know. You guys know Corning Incorporated? He had all these different layers, all these guys above him when he was a young engineer. At my last job at DuPont, here was me, well, I was maybe here, but to get to the boss, we had all this clutter, all these layers of management. So if you're a tech guy, if you're highly technical, you got all these people to communicate with. And these are the guys who talk to customers. So you can sit there in your lab, you can sit there in your desk, you can sit there doing your cell modeling or whatever. Be highly technical. It's okay. It doesn't work that way anymore. Companies have changed. You no longer have these interpreters and all these layers of management. So especially coming out of school soon, you're going to start here. How many people want to work for a startup? Anybody? You're going to be, if you're at a startup, you're not even going to have this layer. You need to learn how to talk to customers and clients, how to sell to them, how to present your stuff in their terms. So how about you folks? Where are you looking to go after school?
Yeah.
Move up.
Move
up?
No.
Okay.
Because I'm a student.
Okay.
I'm a student, I'm not a student.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Work? Do you have a target industry in mind or target goal? Not sure? Okay, that's fine. So, when you can't communicate well, especially from a technical standpoint, we find this can cost companies billions and billions of dollars. This came from Harvard Business Review. Quick thing, they asked the leader of a mortgage business why he ignored the advice. He said, if they showed me a model, it wasn't terms I could make sense of. I didn't even know his group was working on repayment probabilities. Remembers the financial crisis in 2008 when the banks collapsed. Yep. Hey, they knew that they were doing something, but they didn't know what it was because the technical people couldn't communicate to the guys at the top. Bank lost billions in bad loans. So this kind of stuff happens all the time. This is a fun one. need a volunteer. Safety glasses. My last job was with DuPont Consulting Firm, and I work with a bunch of highly technical engineers. Most of them were older than me, they're difficulties, but we had to come up with some management systems to keep the plant from blowing up. If you're working in a refinery, you get a loss of containment, you leak some of the stuff, boom, it explodes. That's a big problem. So our job was to prevent that from happening, prevent people from falling down the stairs and getting their hands cut off, safety. So we're going to do a little exercise, because what we were doing was highly technical, filled with a lot of process engineers. And this holds true for whatever your profession, whether it's medical, lawyers are really bad about this, doctors are terrible with this, talking in their language, not the listener's language. Volunteer. Come on up. And since you are wearing yellow, I'm going to give you the yellow. These came from my friends in Baltimore, from Baltimore Gas and Electric. The nicest group of people I ever worked with. So I am a process engineer in Northern Alberta. Yep, you gotta put your safety. If you're coming onto my plant, you gotta put your personal protective equipment on. So you are the CFO, Chief Financial Officer. You're coming in from New York, Dallas, London. I am a process engineer at a refinery. Now, I've been doing some stuff to make sure this stuff doesn't explode. So as a CFO, what do you care about? Finances. So here's the scenario. We've just been doing a whole lot of process improvements to make sure things are safe. So we don't want stuff blowing up. That's how people die. So I'm going to come to you and say all the things that we've done, and you're going to tell me what you think. Now remember, you're a finance guy. I'm a process guy. I'm a process engineer. So, hey, boss. Hey, I'm so glad you came in from New York. We just ran a PHA and a couple of LOPA analysis, and we found 73 level ones. We found a whole bunch of risk ones. I got 50 management of changes ready to go, and we have a bunch of open action items, but we're moving along in them.
I think
it's
great. So let's start again, so that a
layperson
can understand.
Thank you. Okay, let's try this again. Oh, hey, thanks for coming here. Listen. We did a big hazard analysis. We looked at all the pipes. We went through everything. What we've done is we've reduced our risk of explosion by 75%. We still have a lot of open action items to do, but we're getting to them. We got them ranked by severity. Would you like some more detail?
Definitely. Thank you so much.
Okay. What's the main difference?
We understood you the second time.
Almost. That's one thing. What else?
Don't assume the person you're speaking to understands all of your terms for everything.
Yes, and
given the next steps
and
what would the next step?
She's a chief financial officer. What does she care about?
Finance.
And risk.
Definitely risk.
Right. She cares about risk. So the first thing I said was we've reduced our risk of explosion 75%. And she's thinking, oh, well, wow, if that happens,
insurance costs will go down.
You are reading my mind. You get an A+ today. Insurance costs go down. I've got to deal with state. I've got to deal with the people on Wall Street, tell them what's going on. Okay. So the main thing, yes, thank you very much. So the main thing, we can do this, put it in terms that are important to the listener. Figure out what matters to them. Just like we did in the previous exercises. And meanwhile, in my previous career, we did something similar like this, but I was in Northern Alberta. Anybody been to Calgary? Calgary's a beautiful city. You been there?
Yeah.
You like Calgary?
Yeah, I love it.
Okay. Have you heard of a place called Firebag? It's 700 kilometers due north of Calgary in the oil sands, where they have boreal forest, trees growing for about 10 feet tall, no wildlife because they know better. There's nothing there but oil. So much oil. Interesting place. I don't recommend going there. But it is interesting. Okay, so what did I do the first time? I gotta show you how clever I am, right? How many people have said, I must show my boss how clever I am? Okay, how many people are lying to me? We've all done this, especially engineers. We've all been this guy. What do the bosses really care about? How many people have seen Shark Tank?
Yeah.
You like Shark Tank?
Yeah.
I love that show. I can't watch it anymore because they're all more successful than me. I'm sick of it. I don't want to see this anymore. Okay, so what these guys really care about, you know, I have been this guy. I know you all have, and you all will be. We're all going to do this. I got to show the bosses how smart I am. But what do they really care about?
Growth.
Money. What are they going to get out of this? Is this product going to make money for me? Why do I care? All right. Use terms that are important and interesting to the listener, like we just did. Got to have a cartoon. Every presentation has to have a Dilbert. You missed the meeting. What meeting? The budget meeting you told me to schedule. You never told me when it was. I sent an email. We have all done this. Now, this sounds silly. But yeah. Otherwise, we've opened it. You're a bad email sender. I'll still show you in person. Think back to the last presentation. Are you listening or waiting for me to stop talking? Now, this may sound silly, but this happens all the time, especially with email. How many emails do y'all get each day?
A lot.
When I was a project manager, I was getting sometimes 100. And then sometimes the T&L reports didn't get through, so the guys didn't get paid, and that was an issue. Okay. Did he put it in terms that were important to his boss? Probably not. So, let's review this slide again. Who's going to tell me where the C-suite thinks? Right. Next guys, directors, where do they think?
Financial.
Right, return on investment. Hey, if we build this new production line, what's it going to cost? When are we going to get the money back? Or, hey, if we open up, if we move this call center to India, what's the return on investment? What are my customers going to think? What are the clients going to think? What team's going to be destroyed? Do I have to hire? Do I have to fire? These guys think inside the organization. Okay, let's talk about email. I hate email. Every email, use this once. Before you send it, so what? Especially when you reply to all. Email etiquette. My next door neighbor from college, Jose Irizarry, I've known him since 1986. He went on to become a VP at American Express. So I called him up and said, tell me about email. He said, oh, this is awful. I get so many. What do you want from me? That's what he asks. That's what he wants in every email. What is it you need from me? Is this an FYI? Do you need my approval? Do you need resources? Do you need to schedule a meeting with me? Do you have to tell me something important? What is it you want from me? Put that in the subject line. So he gets this all the time. How many people have worked for a company where we have a standardized email process? You have a culture thing where you put something where you put what's in the subject line. Or how do I rephrase this? Many companies will have email etiquette. They teach their employees in the big companies that this is what we expect in subject lines. This is how we do things. Anybody? Oh yeah, tell me more.
Basically, they gave us an outline of what they wanted, what they wanted in the subject line.
Great. Starting to address it.
Yes.
Yep. Just this week?
Last week.
Okay. I just got a director of sales on board, and I send stuff back and forth to him all the time. And if I needed to do something, I'll say, action required. Otherwise, FYI, this is something that I'm doing. My business partner in this, he doesn't get that. And this is his pet peeve. He clutters me up with so much email, it doesn't matter. And this is his topic. I gotta bust his chops on that one. Okay. Your email should, to some, and I would assume the company does something similar to this. The main message and the summary of the situation. It's probably something you never know. So, oh, good. I get to stop talking. Y'all get to work together. Let's go four and four. So someone from this group slide over to the Alpha Analytics team. We're going to do an exercise, group exercise. You are a software engineer at a cybersecurity firm, and this is based on a true story. Your sales team, they've been trying to sign a major retailer for months, and you think you can build a solution that can identify and prevent their next data breach. Who remembers a certain retailer, ubiquitous retailer? They've got a store up on 117th now. They had a big data breach. They lost all their data. So you're at a company called, I can't tell you who it was. The background here is a buddy of mine, former project manager, great guy. He went on to work for this company in sales and cybersecurity. And he said, we had the answer. We had the solution before it happened. But my guys, they couldn't put it in terms that I could understand. I lost out on $1 million sale, and look what happened to this retailer. So this is a true story. I won't tell you the company, but they had the solution to this. You're going to fix this problem so it doesn't happen again. So you are sitting in your lab hacking away, and you said, I got it. You want to present it to senior leadership? Let's fill this out. Let's take 10 minutes. Maybe let's do it a little quicker than that. So when you all slide over here, fill this out in your email to the senior leader. What goes in the subject line? What's your first sentence? What is your second sentence? Clear as mud? Clear as a bell? Are the instructions clear? Yes, no?
Actually. Remember Best Buy just have a big security breach? They lost a bunch of it. It was Home Depot. Home Depot compromised a bunch of it.
Right, right. The sales staff has been trying for a long time. Because this is a great company for using. I'm brilliant. I got the solution. That happened, like I said, this happened to my buddy.
Yeah, good luck.
Right.
It works.
You can understand what the heck these guys are talking about. Lost out $1 million.
Solution for what breach? Cyber breach. So I can take some action on that.
No, back out
your subject line. There's no context to that. The subject line should be, do you want to lose a rat?
How was the fidelity on that webcam?
The what?
How was the fidelity on this webcam?
Fidelity?
Like clarity.
You say fidelity?
Yeah.
It's not bad.
You get the speaker on there, too.
Yeah. I was toying with some other ideas, like an actual camera on a tripod that I was using.
Okay.
But then it took a while to convert. And the size of the file was always so big, but this feeds right into Photo Booth.
It's designed for it. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's not designed. Are you a Mac user?
Not in yours.
But anyway, so there's just this Photo Booth that opens up right on the Mac, and this links right into it, so I can do immediate playback if I'm doing individual coaching. I can just click back, see how you're swaying back and forth, doing columns and all that stuff. And it's not that bad if I want to send someone a file, but it's really, really easy just to upload it to YouTube.
Okay.
It takes like 2 minutes. It takes a minute to process, but it took me a while to figure out exactly how I want to do this.
Yeah, that makes sense because you need convenience. You don't necessarily need high def, super quiet. People need to see what they're doing.
Yeah.
And say, oh, I do have that annoying tech.
Yeah, and usually I'll have two cameras. I'll have one just record the whole session, and then this is my look back and do playback kind of thing.
The solution that will.
I'm always striving to figure out a system for class communication or class
communication
points.
Looks like
solution sounds more
like,
yeah.
Okay. They're told you got to participate. So they're sitting in the front because they're on the language skills.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a struggle, and they try.
Mm-hmm.
Just think about us and that situation. You've got to contribute to
the
class.
Identify the solution to prevent the next data breach, which was a major breach that we have been going after the past.
Yeah, it's tough teaching different language abilities.
Check on my students. How's it coming?
We have developed it.
Coming.
Okay.
We have developed a solution.
We're selling it to
we want to develop it.
Right.
You can build a solution.
You already got attention. You can keep grabbing attention. Let's just rephrase
that. Yeah,
I
never thought that. Don't try to show your boss how clever you are. Seems so obvious, but it's never really occurred to me to teach that.
Well, that's the thing when you start collaborating, the thing you were talking about, teach people to do stuff without their facial expressions. I've got to tell you a funny story about that from my fraternity days.
We haven't landed them yet.
What time
do
you get to
the other end?
Class is scheduled till 9:30, but always get them out before 9. They're happy.
Because this is, on the one hand, I want to get on with it, but this is what they're learning. This is where I see the education happen. They're struggling through it.
Yeah, we can guarantee.
obvious issues in them, and they
guarantee that
the acquisition of this contract.
Yeah.
The first two sentences,
yeah.
You're just trying to
and which will result in money for
so the rest of it. You can explain the idea,
okay, quick couple hints. Just remember, these guys are thinking outside the company. These are the guys who need to make the decisions about who's going where and who gets shuffled around, that kind of stuff. And you're the brains. You're the smart guy. You're the guy with that light bulb and the tape on his glasses. I must show my boss how clever I am. These guys are basically the sharks.
So,
we'll
send this email to the next
sharks.
Yeah,
so
if we do this,
you've got a good relationship with the C-suite, the CEO, senior leadership. So you want to sell this idea to these guys.
Yeah.
We'll wait till she gets back and we'll go forward.
Sure, sure.
Get another minute. We're on schedule. So we're gonna give just another minute or two, then we're gonna move forward. All right, let's get you guys need some more time or you're good? Need more time? Do you need more time? Okay, good. All right, who wants to go first? Let's go Alpha Team. What'd you come up with? Selling this idea to senior leadership.
Our subject is data breach solution, action required.
Data breach, okay. So you're telling your C-suite what he needs to do. Good thinking. Okay.
But it can be offensive in one way because the supervisor in one of them is telling me what to do.
Yeah. Okay. So that goes in your subject line? Okay. I did that once, got laid off, but that's all right. So what do you have for your first sentence?
We can build a solution that identifies and prevents the next data breach of the major retailer we have been going after.
Okay. And second sentence.
If we implement this solution, we can acquire this retailer and make money for the company.
All right, which is more important to the C-suite? You got a solution for something, or you can get a new customer?
A new customer.
Okay, so I would have put that one first. How about Delta Team?
Okay, so we have for our subject line solution to protect, we just chose a retailer, we chose Macy's data.
Okay.
And the first one is, I believe I have identified a method to prevent Macy's from a potential data breach that could land them as our client.
Okay. Land them as our client. That's good. You can keep going in the right direction. I came up with something a little different, and again, this is all subjective. You know, what to do. So here's, what do the guys at the top care about? So I put, remember, what do you want from me? Okay, so you're on the right track here, actually, but hey, it starts off with a meeting. Hey, I want to inform you about something. So I came up with new revenue stream. Oh, well, I'm the C-suite. I don't necessarily care about these one or two clients at a time, but a new revenue stream? Huh, well, that's going to get my attention. Or discuss technology to sign major client. Oh, well, this sounds good. First sentence, I think we can sign major retailer. Okay. And we have a solution that can prevent a major data breach or a cybersecurity fund. This is how I would present it. Because, like, here's what I want, meeting request. That's where it starts, right? I think we can sign this major retailer. Questions, comments? Yes, no? Remember, going back to my buddy Jose, you need something from me. What is it for me? Do you need me to prove something? What do you want from me? You want a meeting. Oh, what's the WIFM? Why do I care? New revenue stream. Aha. That's something important. Okay. Little review about email. Do's and don'ts. Do. Use the subject to clarify. Ask for action. Here's what I need. Can you help me, boss? And that goes for people at who your colleagues, your direct reports, wardens, what do you want to call them? Edit and proofread. This is something that I started doing many years ago. Use perfect grammar. Your, and your, different words, they're not spelled you are. Maybe you want to text your friends, fine, but in a professional setting, learn to spell. Again, that's a big thing. The text message, you know, I is a capital I, it's not a lowercase I. Use grammar, punctuation, look like a professional. Provide solutions, never complain on email, and be concise. Short sentences are always better. Don't write a novel. And here's one that people do all the time, secondary subjects. If you also want to ask for vacation time, don't put it in that first email where you're saying, here we have your revenue stream. Oh, by the way, can I take some time off? No, these are separate matters. Use a separate email with a separate subject line. Never complain. We've all done this. Who's complained in an email? Okay, we all have. I know you all have. Don't do it. Next, never discuss company politics in an email. Moving forward. Structure can help you understand your audience and sell your idea. Look familiar?
Yeah.
Okay. Then we should go through this very quickly. Let's run through this, and I have 10 minutes here, but I'm going to cut this down to 5 because I want to get you out of here, and I'm hungry. So we recognize this. Let's go through this very quickly. Pick 4 stakeholders. There's 20 stakeholders you could pick. Pick 4. And let's fill this out. And you have 5 minutes, and I'm going to time you on my phone.
Right.
Get ready. Timer. Clock. Where'd it go?
Change the little.
Software engineer goes off.
Start.
Yeah, with the sales team.
Sales team.
Yeah.
Right. Influence.
Yes, it is different.
Yes.
So, okay, hold on, quick pause.
Oh.
When I was working with that company up in Calgary I told you about, it's actually Suncor Energy, anybody heard of them? When we had a stakeholder analysis, we had, I think, 10 columns to figure out what we were going to do. Because we had, what are their concerns, who's going to address this person, what is the rank within the company? Were they from the new company or from the old company? And all these different ones here. So when you use a stakeholder analysis, this is a very powerful tool. This is an abbreviated version. So I just used two columns here that I thought were applicable. So there's my context. Let's go back to your task at hand. Resume.
Okay, so what's a CEO? Let's see what the CEO has. Hi. Well, yeah, I guess because his
reaction would still be.
What's it for signing into your client?
Yeah.
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 Other projects might not.
Yeah, just pick four or five.
Or it might fall back.
So write it all this.
That's like big.
Do you think you can teach us something?
Prioritization.
Generalized. Yeah, the writing emails is a group. That's good exercise. It seems to be resonating.
Yeah, that's how I'm struggling with that.
I think I'm going to add some material next time I teach this class on social media messaging and text messaging.
But reaction is.
I've got to keep it current somehow.
Because they're making their sound.
Take some, do a little bit of that, just like,
yeah.
Like how would we write this
what's
message?
It for
what's
it?
I don't know, we can figure it out. But.
Here's what you could do. You could have two people, both looking at them, both look relatively young, 20, 29, very professional.
But
one sends an email written one way, and the other person sends a message for written professional. And then one sends one just long, it's the same message, but one is all. You are.
Do you
want to
do third? Let's meet them.
Are you
four,
going
right?
To
oh,
mean,
okay.
Are you?
Else.
Say, which one would you like to work with?
The retailer.
Which one do you want to hire? Which one should you get promoted?
What's that? I just saw something on Facebook.
The software engineer.
The grammar lady corrects Taylor Swift's email. It wasn't Taylor Swift, it's someone that Taylor Swift is feuding. And somebody wrote a tweet. No one could understand it. The grammar lady corrects it.
Okay, half time. 2 minutes, 30 seconds.
Time. What's in for me?
Promotion?
Concerns. Can I major retailer
us our previous project? Oh no, sorry.
Can they influence this?
Oh,
whatever they can use to sign a major retailer.
They're going
to
be pitching you for
the
previous project.
The project, like the software,
I know, right?
Yeah. Reaction. We saw the.
You guys are done. Look at that. With 1 minute 37 seconds to spare.
We can make that as their what's in for me.
It's kind of tired. It felt like a lot of pressure.
You've also done it already.
Yeah,
that
too.
Yeah, we need a promotion now. I'll be happy to give you a raise. From all that I've been paying you. I'll double yourself. I'll double what I'm paying.
Effectiveness or lack thereof.
Done?
Yes.
4 minutes? Done in record time. Mazel tov. Okay. Who's up first? Help the team. Who are your stakeholders?
Our CEO.
CEO?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sales.
Sales? Sales staff? Okay.
Me?
Who?
The software engineer.
Oh, the software engineer?
Yeah.
Let's just call him C. Okay.
Same order.
And then VC.
Oh, the client. potential client.
Yeah.
That's right.
Fine. Okay. Okay.
And for the CEO, the importance of hire.
Okay, Alpha team. Okay, go ahead.
And for sales, high. Oh, sorry, medium.
Medium?
Yeah.
Okay, this is influence on the change. Okay.
And for the engineer, is high. For the
Hi, why do you say that?
They could just reject our whole deal.
Okay, then an interest.
We haven't really landed them yet. So.
Okay, yeah, then an interest tip. Well, who cares, right?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the reaction?
Reaction for the CEO is positive.
Positive?
Yeah, everybody's positive.
Positive across the board?
Yeah.
Okay. What's the whiffen for me? What's the whiffen?
For the CEO is revenue.
Okay.
Okay, and for the sales, bonus.
Oh, yeah.
For the ended area is glory.
It's what?
Glory.
And for the Macy's is security.
Okay, security.
Yeah.
Okay, what concerns might they have?
Just same revenue for sales. For the sales, new clients.
New clients?
Yeah.
So, our concerns are, why would I not do this? What could possibly go wrong? Okay, so if you didn't get, we'll come back to that. Okay. Alpha team, what'd you come up with?
Pretty much the same thing. Same exact, in the same order. We can tell you our concerns, though.
Okay.
For the CEO, we had possible loss of other clients.
Okay. Losses?
Sales team was time management. They're devoting all their time to this one.
Interesting.
Client.
Time management.
Software engineer was basically...
Can I deliver?
Yeah.
Can I deliver?
One
possible
time.
Failure.
Can I do it?
Yeah.
Right.
Hey, am I writing a check? I can't cash.
And the major retailer was effectiveness.
Okay. So he's got concerns. Hey, does this stuff really work?
Yeah. Right.
Okay. We're missing one important stakeholder.
The boss.
Yeah, the middle manager guy. Remember? So let's do this guy. Director level, manager. So let's go your immediate boss. Can everyone see that? Can you see this?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So influence on the change, high, medium, or low?
Medium.
Yeah. I think that sounds about right. Okay, what's his reaction going to be?
Positive?
I don't know. It depends. Because they're the ones that have to move everything around.
Right.
There's impact to the work that you're doing for him, so he might not be that happy.
Right. Although he might say, hey, this, I trained you, I can look like a superstar, or he could say, great, I'm wrong.
Depends on who your boss is.
So it depends. Like everything else in life and business, how long does it take to paint the house?
It depends.
Okay, so this could be a whole bunch of different things. The important thing is you start realizing it and start thinking about it. Okay, what's the whiff for me? For the boss. It's hard to see. There may not even be one. So this is, it's quite possible. He could get a gold star for having a great employee. Maybe he brought you in. What do you think his concerns are?
The project, losing you to this,
right.
This new thing.
Yeah, so now he's got to change. You know, the chemistry, Delta needs to change. So then he's thinking, well, great. So if you leave, now I got to replace you. I got to reshuffle these teams. I got these other people demanding stuff from me. I don't have the right resources. So you remember, outside the company, what did they think? Financial resources, teams, and these guys think details. Okay, clear as mud. Everybody got it? Good exercise. Moving forward, this is what I came up with. Basically, yeah, the same stuff you guys did. Yep, we all got pretty much the same stuff here. Very, very similar, slight differences. Next, let's do a real life example. So we are going to do some, if you want to sell these ideas to senior leadership, and each team gets one. So here's my four examples. Who remembers GM Vortec engine? We got any gearheads here? This is the inside of an engine. And if I say intake manifolds and turbulent flow versus laminar flow, does it make sense to anybody? None of you crawled under the car and took it apart and reassembled it? Okay. All right, so I'll tell you about the GM Vortec engine real quick then. Little engineering. gas or liquid goes through a pipe, it goes like this. You want to flow that way, but now you have a lot of back pressure. So what happens is you get much less efficient flow. That's just all over the place, all over the place. But if it flows through and it goes in a vortex, in a circle, you know when water goes down the drain, it starts spinning? What you have is much less back pressure. What that means is you get better fuel economy because your engine runs much more efficiently. So what GM was able to do is they said, hey, instead of having all this flow, just this mess going into the combustion chambers, if it goes nice and smooth and circular and they call it laminar flow, we will get less back pressure, much better gas mileage. Now as a senior leader, I realized, hey, wait a minute. I can meet these government standards for fuel efficiency without spending $10 billion to retool my factories and redesign everything. Oh, I've only got to redesign one little part and I get all those benefits? Wow, that's phenomenal. So you guys as driving trucks don't care. You say, oh wow, I got a lot more horsepower and get a better gas mileage. This came out in the 1980s when gas prices were still pretty high. So if I were selling this to a GM senior leadership, if I were an engineer in 1978, 79, whenever, I'd say, boss, we can improve our mileage to meet the government's mileage standards without retooling everything. And then I tell the marketing guys, hey, listen, we got a new engine here, a big durable engine that we can put a brand on it. Oh, wow. Now, if I'm marketing, I'm going to listen. That's why I would sell this. Let's use some that are a little more current. Who's heard of these three companies? Okay, Dollar Shave Club, anybody use them? Anybody who's familiar with Dollar Shave Club?
I've seen their ads, yeah.
Okay, who's heard of Uber? Okay, who's heard of Netflix? Okay, let's see, do you have a coin? Who's got a quarter? Quarter, nickel, dime. Okay. Alpha team, call it in the air.
Tails.
Tails it is. Which company would you like?
Netflix.
Which company would you like? Okay. This is your task. Where did I put this thing? Let's come up with a technological problem. Let's come up with a customer solution and how you would sell this to senior leadership. This is going to be a little more difficult for you. So we got Uber and Netflix, right? All right, let me go through an example of Dollar Shave Club. This is how I would present this. Dollar Shave Club, we have one or two familiar with it, right?
Yeah.
What Dollar Shave Club does is they mail you a little package of razors, and you don't have to go shopping anymore. And they're pretty good. They're not phenomenal, but they're pretty good. So the technological problem that you would have is the razors would come from China where they're manufactured, go to a distribution place, they wait at a dock distribution house. Then they'd go off to a Procter & Gamble or whoever's warehouse. From there, they would go to a Walmart warehouse. From there, they go to the retailers. Then you, as a customer, that's me, I've got to go there, and the cabinet is locked. And I got to just get a coupon, and then someone else has to move it. So these things are moving all over the place. Think about how much that costs. Think about how much inventory is there. Think of how annoyed I am. These things cost a fortune. So the technological problem was way too much inventory and way too much movement. Customer problem is I'm annoyed because these things are so expensive. I would sell here disruptive technology where I can lower the costs. I can sell the same product for a fraction of the cost and have a cool brand. So that's how I would address this one. That's how I'd sell the senior management. Hey, the competitors, they have 15 people involved. I can sell the same product direct to consumer for a fraction of the price. And instead of having $1 billion worth of razors in inventory in the supply chain, I can get it down to maybe one day's supply. Is anybody in supply chain? you done finance? Have you guys taken finance yet?
Mm-hmm. Okay. We touched on it, but it wasn't into too much detail.
Okay. The way I would address this is, instead of having $1 billion type of inventory, we can have $0 billion type of inventory.
Oh.
Well, that's important. Hey, that's a savings. So, let's get going on this, fill out this. Tell me what, for Uber and Netflix, tell me what problems were solved. Customer, this should be, yeah, technological problem or market problem. What is the big issue here? Why is it successful? Give me the solution, how you present this to senior leadership. There was much, and imagine these boxes are a little bit bigger because your profit title is a little bit more. But keep it concise, one or two sentences.
Netflix, right?
Yeah. Right. Shane just has to several times. People can struggle with it. We're getting close to the end here. This is basically just a general discussion.
So we figure out like what tech problems it solves. Okay.
The reason I was asking you about teaching this is trying to find a job with that.
Yeah.
For a full-time job, they asked me to be a phone interview. So it's basically doing learning and development for them. I'm tired of being broke. So, but I'm not going to give up my phone. So see if I have another teacher. I'm my director of sales.
Yeah, the problem
is slowly build it, just get more and more content.
Yeah.
I got a good trainer. And for you. Stop working.
If I get
a $10,000 training,
this more relates to people
$10,000 engagement.
Not spending money on
$1,000
so,
a day of your training.
Go streaming.
So, but when we get these things.
Customer. Oh, so what was the solution then? Subscription.
Yes.
Streaming.
Is there a good idea?
You're trying to sell. The company hasn't been launched yet. You're trying to sell to a venture capitalist.
We didn't know that these things were going to happen.
We're going to close Uber. Okay, whatever. So the year is 2011 or whenever Uber was launched. Or 1999, whatever.
Well, you would need a computer to.
Remember what was going on with the movies. Remember Blockbuster?
Netflix saw like why people use it to watch.
Remember Blockbuster. That is such an amazing example of change.
And it happened so fast, too.
Yeah.
That's the solution, right?
Yeah. Same thing happened to Kodak.
Yeah.
It had some qualities of digital cameras, but it wasn't quite there. It was a great product. They put all their money into it,
so
and the digital cameras came out, and all of a sudden there was so many more.
So
they put all their money into small cameras, and then the iPhone came out. Hey, nobody needs these anymore.
Or have to wait till DVD goes, or have to wait till movie goes from theater.
Always
DVD.
Rushing for yesterday's technology. Consumer products.
Yeah.
Brutal market.
In Blockbuster, they
lasted a while. It started to go down, and they changed. They had their no new late fees, and then they had their online thing for a while, but they just couldn't do it as well.
What?
Yeah,
they
had all the legacy.
Oh yeah.
They were cannibalizing themselves.
I used to have the video rewinder. Oh my gosh, it took like 10 minutes to rewind. So, how to sell it? It's
are we people that are
variety?
And it
encourages people to pay to watch movies through subscriptions.
Okay, so then we're trying to tap into this market.
Yeah, so for Uber, you're selling to DC.
So we're basically trying to tap into this market. We didn't really care about the downtime before, because we weren't in cabs. We didn't want to cap them. So for us, we're basically just trying to tap into the market. And then you're creating a little.
There will always be new subscribers, because there will always be. Swapping movies and stuff, I'm sure more people will sell.
The revenue by cap
and it would be
basically
because it's a guarantee
of a dime. Blockbuster started going out. Blockbuster's trying to do some things. So, just hours in there trying to pick
find
the
movies and try to find it.
Yeah. Right? Can you imagine, like,
Quick hint. What gets venture capitalists all excited? It gets them all hot and bothered. Disruptive technologies.
Okay.
Keep that in mind.
Okay.
All right. Give a couple more minutes and let's get this wrapped up here.
I used to have the CD rack, and then I would really put all these CDs. put up one. I started.
Okay, let's get this thing wrapped up here. This is our last big exercise. Then we'll have a brief discussion. So, let's start with the Netflix folks. Tell me what you came up with.
The tech problem that we were solving for was legal streaming and bootlegging.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
The solution that Netflix provided was subscription-based streaming.
Okay.
So for customer problems, we had that it was hard to find a variety of movies. It took a lot of time to travel to movie theaters and stores, and then it ended up costing a lot of money in late fees and movie tickets. Whereas Netflix has one flat fee, it's economical, there's a variety of movies for everyone, and it's super convenient.
Yep.
So how do we sell it? It's a consistent stream of money through subscriptions for the company, and there's endless customer and growth potential.
Yep, okay. Interesting, I like it. One thing I learned, I heard a speaker many years ago, and he told me something that always stuck with me. He said, every great product has two things. Brand and a convenience. Think about Sirius Radio. Oh, I can get all those old stations. I'm looking for these songs in this kind of genre for so long. Oh, Netflix. Yeah, I got the brand. I no longer have to go to the store, rent a movie, get it back by the end of the day. I just mail back when I want. Remember they started as the, before they had the bandwidth. They're mailed to you, keep it as long as you want, mail back, we'll send you a new one. So I got a brand and a convenience. Okay, good. Uber, what'd you come up with?
The technological problem was logistics. How to find customers on the street. Sometimes people don't have the money to pay, and the drivers fear for their safety sometimes.
Maybe, I was thinking something else, but go on.
Okay. Now for a customer problem, hailing a cab, having to go out to a main street to find cabs that are driving by. Also, the customer safety.
Yeah.
Money.
Yeah.
You barely ever know how much they're going to charge you. And again, the location.
Yep. Yeah.
How we were going to sell it to senior management or venture capitalists is by telling them how much you can make per hour with a regular cab. And with our technology, how much a cab could make per hour, that we could increase that, we just made up, we can increase it to twice the amount by reducing the idle times, because our cabs are going to go pick up people. Each driver is going to be equipped by a GPS smartphone, and the customers are going to be requesting by location where they want to be.
I'm going to push back on that, because if I'm a venture capitalist, I don't care about the technology. I figure, you guys are smart, you'll figure that out. But here's what I came up with. Okay, Uber. Technological problem. And you touched on this, you guys got this. The dispatch and license systems are antiquated and inefficient. The cost of a cab medallion has gone like this. This is about $1 million. That's why you have a few people who can afford this. But over the last, say, 5-6 years, the cost of medallions just skyrocketed. And Uber came in and said, oh, we can, this is stupid, we don't need any of that stuff. And who's ever tried to get a taxi when it's raining? How about on the Upper East Side at, let's say, 8:30 in the morning? It's impossible. But at Penn Station, at the same time, there's too many cabs. So what this is really care about is disruptive technologies. That's really that's what these guys care about. That's their thing. How are you going to disrupt it? Well, you get that in the details. But the VCs, that's their big thing. Netflix, here's what I came up with. It would complex and expensive.
And when you went to the video store, remember the Seinfeld episode where they watched the movies? You guys remember that? In the 90s? It seems like yesterday. They had to carry all that inventory, and they have the store, and the people there, and the staff, and the clothes. And then, as the customer was totally inconvenient, their solution sell directly to customer, either direct mail or through streaming. Disruptive service. And you can get rid of all that extra inventory, especially when you get to streaming. You guys know anything about lean manufacturing, lean principles? Lean manufacturing? Okay, lesson for another day. So, this is how I came up with it. You guys, I think you got that. Maybe just a little different wording, but I think both teams started to get it. So, questions on this exercise. Okay, so let's talk about this here. So, yes, everybody knows the Shark Tank?
Yeah.
Okay, Shark Tank, watch. Love the show, hate the show. Imagine you are the sharks, or you're an investor, or you're the C-suite at General Motors, you're a venture capitalist. You have investment money. The way we presented this information, is it good? What do you think? What else? What would you like to see from the investors? I'm asking you to put yourself in their shoes. Remember, I like this little pointer. You're up here, you're thinking outside the company. And let's talk about these two questions. And this is an open discussion. What do you think? What are your thoughts?
Are we talking about based on what we just did, the exercise that we did?
Yeah, what are you going to do differently? What are you comfortable with? What are you not comfortable with? Where are you going to struggle? What are your next steps?
I do like how the information was broken down, like this is the problem, this is the solution. What would I do differently? It's hard to tell because we were very vague with ours, so
okay.
We were more.
So what do you do differently? You all have some kind of skill, whether it's engineering or legal or I don't know your backgrounds, but something. What are you going to do differently? What are you going to think through? How are you going to present stuff differently now? So when you go home tomorrow morning and say, what do you think about this?
Trying to come up with a structure.
Okay.
You gave us some structure. Might apply sometimes, maybe sometimes the audience is different, but the main thing is to think about who your recipient is so that you can appeal to them with the what's in it for you, with the recipient message.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm in reinsurance, and we basically do recoveries.
You do? I'm sorry.
Recovery,
okay.
And the director's goal is to bring in the money for the organization. If we have any problems, any issues that would impede that process, that's what I would touch first.
Okay.
The problem, the solution.
Okay.
And an estimated time period was to fix that.
Okay. Because that's what they care about.
Yes.
Don't tell me the problems.
Yes.
Tell me, what is the solution Holland's going to take? Keep me posted.
Whereas before, I would give you a grid of everything that's happening.
Exactly.
As a matter of fact, I have one of my saved now that as you were talking, most of that will be.
Yeah. You might even say, hey boss, what is important to you? Here's all the information. What do you want to see? Okay. Other questions, comments? Okay. Well, let's do a quick review. You've seen this outside, finances and resources, inside the organization, these are the tech guys. Let's do it quick. Like you said, start with the conclusion. What does all this mean to me? It'll be done in a week. That's the conclusion. Options, recommendations, do your homework, listen. And this one, try to put yourself in that senior leader's position. It's going to be hard for you to do. Because you're not there. You haven't been there. But you can try and start thinking about what's important to them. And God forbid, you could ask. Say, hey boss, I'm kind of new here. What's going to help you do your job? What do you need from me? How can I make you look like a star, Mr. Supervisor? Don't start with the details. Yeah, they know you're brilliant. Don't assume your bosses know all the technology. Lawyers and doctors are the worst with this one. They give you so much jargon and initialisms. Who knows what a PHA is? Process hazard analysis. Who cares what a PHA is?
What's
who cares, Mr. CFO, about risk reduction?
What's an initialism?
An acronym is RADAR. It's radio and detective something or other, or sonar, sound and navigational, I don't know. An initialism is the NFL. Everybody knows what the NFL is, National Football League. That's the difference. Notion?
Oh, it's something everyone knows?
Yeah.
Okay.
No. An initialism is something that you just use the initials. The FBI.
Okay.
The Federal Bureau of Investigation. The CIA. And my least favorite is the IRS. If you talk about the IRS, everybody knows what you're talking about. But another one is if you take a bunch of letters
okay. And
you put them together. What's another initial? Another acronym? I know radar, sonar, laser, light emitting something or other. Light and...
Swans.
Swans test. Yes, except for that one. That is a good acronym. Where do I have acronyms? I don't have it up here. Oh, let me use a lot of things. But you can use the Swans test. And then you can actually show them how... Then you can show your brilliance if you use mine. And give me credit. Don't assume the boss cares about your problems. Like you said, all the details I'm going to do, what's going to be that? Okay. Oh, yeah, we're done.
Yay.
Yeah, so questions, comments. What would you like to see? I got websites, I got all sorts of stuff. Or did we get all the questions and comments out during the day?
Okay. Do you have some videos on your website? Maybe we could log on and watch at some point?
Absolutely. Communicationforgeeks.com is my website. We're launching an e-learning class. We have a couple of those that are coming. You'll see lots of brilliance in our blog. I think it's brilliant because I wrote it. And everything is based on a business case. It's not from an academic standpoint. My background is not communications. It's management consulting, biochemistry, engineering. So it's based on real stuff, very little academic stuff. It's all very practical, at least I think so. Okay, so you guys have my website. If you send an email that goes directly to me, please feel free to email me. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to help. Just remember, put yourself in my shoes. Tell me who you are and how we met. I just got an email today, and I said, who the heck? Just came from through LinkedIn. She asked me something, and I said, who the heck is this? And it took me a long time to figure it out, so I didn't want to be impolite, but don't do that to me, please. Just, hey, thank you for guest lecturing at the class. I am so-and-so, and then I'll be happy to respond as quickly as possible. But any questions or comments or feedback in the course, even better.
Thank you.
Hope you guys learned something.